Back off, man. I'm a scientist.
Hello, welcome to Totally 80s and 90s Recall, where the vibes are fly and the nostalgia's cranked up to the max. Whether you're a new kid on the block or a longtime listener, we're totally stoked to have you riding this radical wave of memories with us. On this podcast, we're going to take you on a journey through the greatest hits, wildest trends, and most gnarly moments from the days of our youth in the 80s and 90s. I am one of your hosts, David, chilling, as always, at the crib with the notorious R.O.B., a.k.a. my good friend Rob.
Wow. Ooh, baby, I like it.
That was a mouthful.
So today shouldn't say things are mouthful while the Raw song is playing.
Today's episode goes out to all of you that are experiencing a bit of the paranormal. Are you troubled by strange noises in the middle of the night? Do you experience feelings of dread in your basement or attic? Have you or your family ever been seen a spook, specter, or ghost? If the answer is yes, then don't wait a minute. Turn on your favorite podcast. Our courteous and efficient staff is on call 24 hours a day to serve all your supernatural elimination needs. Now, if there's something strange in your neighborhood, if there's something weird and it don't look good, maybe you've got an invisible man sleeping in your bed. That's weird. Maybe you're all alone. Maybe you're sleeping. You're seeing things running through your head. If you've had a dose of a freaky ghost, let us tell you something. If you walk away from today's episode hearing nothing, at least hear this. Bustin' makes us feel good.
It does.
Yeah. The Total 80s and 90s Recall team ain't afraid of no ghost. And we're ready to believe you.
Nice. Mm-hmm. I think you got us ready to go.
Yeah, there
you go. Well, just like the topic for our episode today, we can't just do this with two people. Huh? So before we begin jumping into our topic, we have to introduce our third person here today joining us. Fresh from being roasted in the depths of Slore, the keeper of the VHS DVD vault, our resident film aficionado, it is, of course, the movie hound, Kurt.
Wow.
Thank you.
You came loaded today.
He did. I think he used AI to come up with big words for him and stuff. So it's good. Well, thank you for having me back.
First of all, there's no AI. I'm just typing things. I got time.
I think you might possibly be AI.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe they should pay me for that.
Because sometimes I just don't understand.
Instead of ChatGPT, right. Is David GPT.
Oh, great.
That's what it is. Okay.
That's something
just
new.
Going anyway, to his head. Yes.
All right.
Well, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you.
It's great to have you back.
Is it?
Always.
Is it?
Okay.
No, he's asking that.
Yeah.
He's like, is it? He's it asking is? Himself that question.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Just hopefully by the end of the day, you guys won't be crying to cross streams to get rid of him.
Because
that would be gross.
I wondered how many times we get cross streams into it.
Yeah.
So that was early.
You're welcome.
It came way earlier than I almost anticipated.
Well, it's like your honeymoon.
wow. Shot across the back.
Wow.
I almost crossed streams once at that bar in Ellensburg, the Horseshoe, because they had the trough in the bathroom, yeah. Not regular toilets.
The tab has a trough, too.
Yeah. And me and the guy next to me, we were a little tipsy. So we got close, but
swinging together.
World didn't end, so no streams were crossed in the end. So that's good.
They might have been crossed, but the world didn't end.
But you could tell I was drinking Bud Light. Old boy was drinking something else because I had a much lighter stream than he did.
Why are you paying attention?
Why do you know that?
Yeah, you're just kind of looking around. Plus, I had to keep an eye to make sure he didn't cross. I don't want to die.
You should keep your eye to yourself in the bathroom.
You're on the trough. You can't. You got to watch what's going on.
I'm just looking around.
No, you just watched the brick in front of you. That's it.
That is a rookie move because I was watching ahead one time and it hit the foot and it wasn't mine. So someone peed on my foot. Not happy about that. All right. That was in Florida. So bad on the Florida trough people. Yeah. So you'd think everyone would know how to pee into a trough at this point in their lives. But apparently it's not as easy as it seems.
Apparently not.
So yeah, right on my foot. Had some new sneakers on. Just gross. Next day, toothbrush. Had to scrub the shoes off.
No, you just throw those away.
No. What? No, they were new. I can't throw them away. Just get a little bleach out.
It's okay. A little bleach out.
It's just urine. We've all been around here.
Rob, where was this on your opening of the show conversation?
I never saw this coming.
Oh, well, it kind of went from crossing streams to pee trough.
Yeah.
Have you not used a pee trough before?
Yeah. Oh, okay. The Tav has one.
Oh, do they? Does the Tav have one?
It's a trough.
Yeah. I mean, it's super functional. You get in and out real quick.
Super smart.
Yeah. I mean, But all rules about like the urinals where you don't stand right next to someone, those out the window because you got to wedge in. You just got to find, you got to fit in where you get in.
That's right.
Make it happen. So you just be like, you can almost stand sideways. Just be like, hey, here, just let me have a little crack. Anyway,
just make a little space.
That's what you got to do.
Wow.
That's sometimes it's why it's nice to be males because we can kind of just make that space.
Okay.
There's no pee trough in a woman's bathroom. Almost impossible to do that. You imagine just that's seven just floor squatted drain. People at once across the that wouldn't make any sense. Be rough.
What the heck, man?
All right. Well, let's let's get back to this stream crossing conversation later. Rob, go ahead and tell everyone what topic we're covering for this week's episode.
1984's Ghostbusters.
Oh, Ghostbusters. Well, before we begin reminiscing about this awesome film, because it is awesome, 1984, you said, right?
Yes.
40-year anniversary this year, yes. But Kurt, why don't you share with us, before we dip in and tell everybody what we think of it, let's go to the experts. Roger and Gene, the resident review masters from the 80s and 90s, and what were their thoughts about Ghostbusters?
Alrighty, so their thoughts come straight from the balcony. I watched it on YouTube. We got Roger Ebert says, Ghostbusters is a head-on collision between two comedic approaches that have rarely worked together very successfully. Although this time, they do. One of them is a special effects blockbuster and a sly dialogue movie. So they're combining, which everyone talks like a smart graduate student who are in on the joke. Let's see here. We've got the movie stars three graduates of Second City National Lampoon Saturday Night Live tradition. They're funny, but they're not afraid to reveal that they're also quick-witted and intelligent. Their dialogue puts nice little spins on American cliches, and it uses understatement, irony, in-jokes, vast cynicism, and cheerful goofiness. Oh. Rarely has a movie this expansive provided so many quotable lines, which we'll see later on when we do our favorite quotes.
I may have missed it at the beginning, but which one of them said this?
This was Robert.
Okay, Roger.
Roger, that's right.
You combined Roger Ebert and just said his name's now Robert.
Robert.
That's right.
Yeah, there you go.
He wants to be a Robster. Okay, so. That's it.
Robert. So this is Uncle Raj. Right
that was
Uncle Roger.
That was Uncle Raj. Yeah. Gene says the movie eventually degenerates into a mindless sound and light show that could have appeared in many other lesser movies. He was not a fan of the special effects.
Wow. Oh, come on, Gene.
But he does say this film is a whole lot funnier when its characters are talking to and past each other than when everybody is standing around in awe of not particularly awesome special effects. Still on balance, Ghostbusters is a hoot. It's Murray's picture, and in a triumph of mind over matter, he blows away the film's boring special effects with his one-liners.
Yeah. Oh, so he does like it.
He does. Well, they both gave them thumbs up from the balcony.
Did you get stars on that? Did they? Because sometimes Raj likes to give out
Raj gave 3.5 stars.
Wow, that's really good. 3.5 out of 4 is good. Yes. So. Now, I will say, it's perfect Gene Siskel-esque that he liked it, but still had to throw a little jab in there somehow. He always did that. Even on movies he liked, he had to throw in like, well, there was 10 minutes that I slept, or, you know, I had to get popcorn.
I had a teacher one time when I did an eval ask me, so do you, when you do these, do you have to, like, give critical feedback?
Yes.
I'm like, yes, I do.
How will we get better?
Right.
That's right.
Right.
I feel that's kind of like Siskel, right? He can't just say
it was great.
Yeah, he's got to go, there's some parts of it.
So you're kind of favoring his attitude here by saying he's providing the director with a little critical feedback.
I relate to him.
Oh, okay. Yeah. That's right. So you're Siskel-ish? Mm-hmm. Nobody wants to be Siskel-ish.
No,
you want to be more Roger-ish.
Roger was the tall one.
No.
No, that was Siskel.
That was Siskel. Siskel was the tall guy.
Yeah, with the big glasses. Yeah. Feels like you could use a good Rogering. I think that's the way that's going to work. So.
I don't know that I like that.
Well, I don't like that.
It's not meant to be liked. It just is what it is. All right. So
you just take it.
We're always ready to take it. He told us before. So that's fine. So, well, now that we've heard what Siskel and Ebert think, for the most part, that sounds pretty good. Siskel again, had to have a little bit in there that's a little negative. Not overly, but a little bit. So, but what do we remember about watching this for the first time, Kurt?
Ooh, for me, I would say I probably watched it probably 86, 87, not when it came out. Four-year-old me wasn't big into it. But I do remember watching it, and it was, I really liked it, of course. But I didn't pick up on all the subtle jokes that Venkman was spitting out there. But I liked, I liked the ghosts. Oh, I liked the whole story behind it. The Stay Puft Marshmallow Man. It really spoke to me.
I know.
Now I am the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
So you're a sailor. You're in New York.
That's right.
Just gotta get you laid.
Just gotta get me laid.
What about you, Rob?
I know we've joked about this in the past, but this was a babysitter movie.
Of course.
Seems this is like where it. I was exposed to it.
This didn't make it to the house?
I don't remember it being at the house.
I can't. Your dad didn't like, I could feel like your dad would have.
I don't remember it being at the house. Yeah. But makes sense. Because my babysitter was a, she was a paranormal
enthusiast.
Fan. Yes.
That's right.
Yeah. She, I think she thought her house was haunted and, and so she was really into that stuff. But yeah, she used to, the one liners that he said, and those are all things that I remember.
Oh,
you
know, yeah.
Like you said, the review about it being so quotable.
Yeah.
And that was.
That's what it is.
Yeah. But I think the idea of being kind of what you said, it was, it hit all the buttons for a kid, right? Mm-hmm. It had action, it had ghosts, it had, you know, cars, it had all the things. So
everything. Twinkies.
Yeah. Food.
Yeah. Yeah. It's got everything you need.
Marshmallows. Mm-hmm. Yeah, had pretty girls.
Oh, yeah.
Sigourney was looking good.
She was. Yeah. Janine's not looking bad.
No.
I kind of like the glasses. Yeah.
Her bug eyes.
Yeah. Her, sorry about the bug eyes. But, well, this is, I would say if I had a top three movies of the 80s, this is easy. This is in that. I saw this at the theater. I remember. I went with my dad. My dad really liked Bill Murray. And then we watched it. I think we bought it. I think we had the physical copy of it. And we would watch it. And my dad would laugh. We'll talk about it later. But that one scene at the elevator where he says they're exterminators. And the guy goes, someone saw a cockroach. He goes, it must be a big cockroach. He goes, bite your head off, man. My dad would laugh so hard to that. Like he thought it was the funniest thing in the world. So, but I just remember he really laughed a lot at the Bill Murray stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Not that he didn't laugh at other parts, but the Bill Murray. So for me, like you said, this is everything. I watched the cartoons.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I had the car at one point.
Mm-hmm. I remember having Egon in this little proton bag.
I think I went at Halloween. I think I went as a Ghostbuster one year.
I was always a bum.
I didn't have a proton pack. We weren't a rich family. I think they just got me some coveralls, you know, and said, you're a Ghostbuster.
Wrote your name on it.
Yeah, have fun.
With a Sharpie.
Carry this stick.
I don't even know if they were brown coveralls, but they were coveralls. Just tell people you're a Ghostbuster. And then I could see my mom, getting it, one of those fabric stores or something, like the Ghostbuster thing, and then, ironing it on my thing or something.
Yeah. That's funny. Yeah, that...
Oh, did you lose it?
No.
That was quite a dramatic, awkward pause you had right there. Like, you started talking, so Kurt and I are like, oh,
no.
He's going to have something.
It's coming? No, it's gone.
No, no, but the toys, that was huge.
Oh, everything.
I mean, it was a cultural thing, the whole Ghostbusters thing.
Music, we've talked about their soundtrack before. I mean, from a pop culture standpoint, this is probably one of, again, the top 2 to 3 pop culture movies. And of course, now it spawned, it had a sequel in 1989. Then there was a reimagining in 2016, which Kurt and I have both been on record. The all girl Ghostbusters.
It's funny.
It's good. And Rob too, seems to be a pretty controversial take, but we like it. I thought it was funny. I think Chris Hemsworth is funny in that movie, but I tell other people that and they look at me like I'm the craziest person that ever walked around, but I thought it was funny. So, and everyone's like, oh, it's a bad sequel. I go, it's not a sequel. It's just a different version of being a Ghostbuster. But, and then I've seen the 2 new ones, which I think are good. They're kind of another, they're trying to extend the universe or whatever. But none of them, in my opinion, are as good as the first one. The first one.
Yeah.
There are parts of 2 that I think are funny. But the whole movie itself is not as good as the first
Ghostbusters 2?
Yes. Well, because they kind of just run it back.
Yeah.
Like, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. You know what I mean?
But there's a river of slime.
There's a river of slime.
So. I don't know if we'll talk about it, but.
We talk about everything, Rob.
I read a theory on that.
Okay. On what?
On Ghostbusters 2.
Oh. Do we want to do that, or you want to save it for when we do Ghostbusters 2?
Are we doing Ghostbusters?
Well, of course we will at some point. We can't. Well, that's pretty good. I want to, if for no other reason, I want to talk about the Bobby Brown song. So at some point, we'll just do a whole podcast.
I read a theory that said that Ghostbusters 2, that they They actually died at the end of Ghostbusters 1.
Oh, okay.
So Ghostbusters 2 is them in some kind of purgatory or
so
something.
So they're ghosts now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And this is them just imagining what they're doing? Mm-hmm. Chasing Vigo? Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Viggy. Bad boy.
Yeah. So, well, it's essentially the same movie.
Correct. Mm-hmm. It is. They just run it back. Yeah. They make it real simple. Yeah. So, well, I think we're all pretty much on the same.
Yeah.
When we say 80 icon movies, if I was doing a top five, for me, this is like, you know, Back to the Future, Ghostbusters. Yep. Mm-hmm. I'd really have to sit down and think about it. Probably Beverly Hills Cop. Man, it's tough. But, you know.
Ghostbusters. Trying to think.
Ghostbusters. Yeah. Ghostbusters might be my favorite movie from the 1980s.
Yeah.
If I was going to say what my favorite 80s movie is, and that's across all genres, and the one I rewatch the most, and the one I still like quote the most, and the one that, like, if it's on TV, I will always watch it no matter what. Ghostbusters is probably that. So I would say it's probably my favorite movie as a kid into an adult from the 80s. Yeah.
The dialogue in it's really good.
Yep.
It's super funny and quick. And
I mean, nothing wrong. It was rated PG. Interesting. Well,
80s PG.
But of course, the 80s PG. Yeah. And there was no PG-13 at this time.
Yeah.
So they didn't have a choice. Because the second one was PG-13.
Mm-hmm. Getting, you know, fellatio
in
from
ethereal,
a ghost.
Ethereal fellatio.
Ethereal. That, right. That didn't kick up the rating at all. Or?
No, because you don't actually know what happened. You're making
it's
a lot
just
of assumptions.
I'm zipping. We don't know what happened.
His eyes crossed. That's he could have had a bug fly up his nose. Yeah. We don't know what went on.
When I was...
You're making assumptions, right? So, but they do kind of, they try to give you a direction. They're like, this could be a thing, you know, but we don't
know. What you inference just says more about you.
That is true. Other people could have seen that as like a foot massage or something. He had a long day, or maybe he's got to get into his coveralls and she's helping him out.
Ghost was just making him more comfortable. Who goes to sleep with a belt on?
Yeah, no doubt. But I think that alerts how tired he is.
That's right.
He just passed out in his clothes. So...
I apologize. For that.
Well, I think we're all on the same page here that this is a pretty memorable and classic movie for all of us.
Yeah.
Very rewatchable. So for those of you that if you haven't seen it, we're going to spoil it all today. But if you haven't seen it by now, 40 years later,
who hasn't seen it?
Would you like to run into someone and be like,
oh, never seen it?
Although
never heard
you
of
haven't
it.
Seen Bloodsport or like Roadhouse.
I've seen
that blows
them.
My mind.
I just don't watch them multiple times.
You should know enough about them to at least quote some parts of it, and you don't. That blows my mind completely out.
I do work with a lady who's in her mid to late 20s that has not seen many movies.
Okay. Well,
and it's a running joke that
this is true.
You haven't seen that.
Yeah.
So she didn't know who Eddie Murphy was.
That's so was she Amish beforehand or like, come on. I mean, come on. Let's be smart here. Did you not have access to anything? 20 something years?
That was a good one.
So, yeah. So,
Amish.
Well, them, I would say yes. The 20 somethings, there's a good chance. But the target audience of probably who listens to the three of us talk on a podcast most likely has seen Ghostbusters at this point. So, before we jump into exploring more of this movie, let's take a quick ride down memory lane and listen to the original theatrical trailer.
Ghosts.
Hello, Ghostbusters.
They're real.
You do? You have?
They're here. Ghostbusters.
Hey, anybody see a ghost?
They catch the ghost that won't stay dead. They're armed. They're dangerous.
Try to imagine all life as you know it stopping instantaneously and every molecule in your body exploding at the speed of light.
All right, that's bad. Okay. All right, important safety tip. Thanks, Egon.
They're professionals.
Oh. I'm the chairman of the largest paranormal removal company in America.
You see it?
They're all that stand between you and the end of the world.
The city is headed for a disaster of biblical proportion.
Real wrath of God type stuff.
Exactly.
Fire and brimstone coming down from the sky.
Human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together. Mass hysteria.
Your girlfriend lives in the corner penthouse of Spook Central.
You want this body?
Is this a trick question? Got your stick?
Hold! Hit him up!
Smoke it!
Make him hard!
Ready!
Ghostbusters. Starring Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, Sigourney Weaver, Harold Ramis, Rick Moranis. Coming to save the world.
Who you gonna call?
Ghostbusters.
We came, we saw, we kicked it.
Oh. By the way, good for you censoring the bad words.
It did it on its own.
Oh, okay. Well,
I don't like that announcer.
I was going to say, really? I saw your face. I like him. That guy's is like this. It almost sounded like you just got like a gruff old New Yorker to just come in and just.
I think he's supposed to be setting some sort of mood.
Bill Murray.
Yeah.
That's right.
You can do it.
It's stupid.
Bill Murray, Ghostbusters.
It's so dumb.
I like it. I noticed Harold Ramis got fourth billing on that. He's one of the actual Ghostbusters, but Sigourney Weaver, sure. I guess Alien.
And Winston got nothing.
No.
Poor Winston.
No. Poor Winston. So that's not his fault. Yeah. He's trying. So, good trailer, right?
That was good.
It actually doesn't give away too much.
No.
So, I mean, there's parts. Mm-hmm. Couple quotes I prefer if they'd have left out because it would have been funnier to see him like the first time. Like the good safety tip.
Yeah.
I don't want you to give that away, but you gave it away. So, but yeah, other than that, pretty good. And not too long. Some of our movies we've done lately, the trailers, you go back.
Really long.
Just keep going,
going on here? Like, I've started to think. I'm no,
that's going to hurt.
Cinephile, so I'll yield to the expertise of the movie hound. But I think when they do a really long trailer, they're not confident this is a great movie. That's what I've started to decide.
They're just trying to put in as much as possible.
Because they need to really attract you to get to the movies. Whereas if you've got a shorter trailer, you're like, look, this thing's a home run. Everyone's going to go no matter what we do. So we just got to give them a little bit and we go. But if you got like a 4-minute trailer, I think you're like, we really got to convince these folks this is going to be worth your time.
What do you think about when this came out, Bill Murray, all those guys were hot. Right?
Top of the game.
I mean, they didn't need to.
Is Dan Aykroyd hot?
I don't know, but SNL. I mean, the SNL things.
And then he had Blues Brothers.
Yeah. You got Sigourney Weaver.
Murray's hot, for sure.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think
he's so hot.
So hot right now. Sigourney, so hot right now.
Yeah. So anyway, that's
yes,
you nice. Did like her in her leotard, though, yes.
Oh, I like, yeah, she was looking good.
And she's your height, apparently.
Is she?
She's a monstrosity. You see her in that movie. She's taller than everyone on set. Like, wow. And she's already, I think, like 5'10", and then the hair just makes her 6'3". I don't know.
The hair.
She's like, yeah, she should be playing for like Tennessee or something.
Yeah.
She should be a power forward.
Yeah.
She's not messing around.
Yeah, she's not heavy enough.
At the power forward position, Ripley. I was looking over. We'll get to that in a few minutes. So, because I was looking at something.
Okay.
Okay.
Dave is running the board today.
I'm running the board, but it's not.
I set up the.
Yeah,
the board.
It's a little chaotic,
and so it's not.
Yeah, the
setup's not set up
chaotic.
Very efficiently.
Yeah. So that's right. I'm making my way through it.
Yeah.
So I was kind of killing a little time with that power forward situation because I had to look for the button I needed. So, but I have since found
excellent.
The button.
Good
so,
work.
All right. Well, Vince Clortho, Zool, Slimer. Gozer and Walter Peck. That's right. We're gearing up to bust all the ghosts we can find as we charge our proton packs and hang out with the ultimate paranormal team, the Ghostbusters.
Trapped and she threw the joint and stepped right in.
almost like that song as much as Ghostbusters.
It's okay.
I had this album, and I used to listen to that a lot. I'd just be in my room.
In your Ghostbusters costume?
In my coveralls. Yeah. We're not brown, I think.
You're fake.
So, yeah. Just doing a little like, swinging the... I thought I was in a 50s diner or something. I don't know.
What are you doing?
It's the finger pointing.
With the two fingers.
I remember seeing that movie Blast from the Past, and Brendan Fraser would do a little finger wag while he was dancing, so I assume that's what you should do.
But I don't think he did it with both hands.
I think he did both hands.
No, it's just a one-hander.
A hand on the hip?
Yep.
Okay.
That seems right.
Well, next time I'll put the hand on the hip, and I'll make sure I get the right finger
wag. But will you dip and dip and dip?
I will dip and dip and dip.
Wow.
All right. Well, before we dive into this week's movie, we like to make sure our listeners are fully equipped with all the crucial intel. For that, I'm tossing it over to the movie hound himself, the guy who can sniff out a classic flick faster than a ghost can make a mess. Kurt, give us the scoop on this week's cinematic treasure.
All righty. So we got Ghostbusters is a 1984 American supernatural comedy directed by Ivan Reitman and written by Dan Aykroyd and Harold Ramis. It stars Bill Murray, Aykroyd, Ramis, Sigourney Weaver, and Rick Moranis, and features Annie Potts, Ernie Hudson, and William Atherton. The movie had a budget of around $25 million and made almost $300 at the box office. This movie is certified fresh on the Rotten Tomatoes with a tomato meter score, which now is what they call the critic score rating, of 95%.
Ooh.
And a popcorn meter, which is what they now call the audience. They just changed the names of these things, of 88%. The movie also includes the Billboard Hot 100 number one hit, Ghostbusters, written and performed by Ray Parker Jr.
Mm.
Now, Rob, as David contemplates whether or not it's too warm in here for Bree, please tell us what this movie is about by doing a little segment we call The Back of the Book.
Excellent!
Rob set up the board this week. He did not give himself that button.
Oh, so that's right.
We I back didn't of the give box, you the back of the box.
Yeah, back of the box. We had to do it for him.
That's right. There you go.
So. When ghosts go on a rampage, only three men can save the world. It's Ghostbusters, starring Bill Murray, Dan Aykroyd, and Harold Ramis as a maniacal band of parapsychologists specializing in psychic phenomena and supernatural hilarity. Fired from university research jobs. Sorry, I'm going to start over.
Oh, you're good.
No,
I like it.
Yeah. Fired from university research jobs, Doctors Venkman, Murray, Stans, Aykroyd, and Spangler, Ramis, set up shop as Ghostbusters, ridding Manhattan of bizarre apparitions. But the spirit exterminators are severely tested when beautiful Dana Barrett, Sigourney Weaver, and her nerdy neighbor, Rick Moranis, become possessed by demons living in their building. Soon every spook in the city is loose, and our heroes face their supreme challenge at a rooftop demonic shrine.
Mm.
If you want your spirits raised, that's clever.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Who are you going to call Ghostbusters?
Beautiful.
Approximate 105 minutes.
Good.
Rated PG. Color.
Mm.
There you go.
Columbia or Universal?
It's RCA. Yeah, RCA. Columbia Pictures.
Columbia Pictures.
There you go.
There you go. You read that back of the box almost as if you've never read dialogue in your life.
The cough drop kept getting in the way.
Damn it.
It's like, wow.
It was bad.
He's a 20-plus year educator.
I just want to say.
Couldn't read at all.
It's a good thing because we couldn't have both bad readers.
Oh, yeah. I know. You nailed it.
Clean.
It was
the first time in a long time. I was clean.
As a whistle.
I actually have a picture of the back of the box here. And they've got a nice picture of Sigourney Weaver.
Oh,
yeah.
And maybe he was just distracted.
I was distracted.
Just gonna lay out there. Very enamored with Sigourney today.
Rob, she looked good in her little sheer dress thing she had going on there.
Did you? And that coat. Even Peter commented on this coat you're wearing is fantastic.
Oh, not the coat.
I like
that sheer thing she's wearing. She's floating and when she was Zool.
Well, we have some categories we're going to go into here in a few minutes to kind of lay out our favorite parts of the movie. Before we jump into those, we want to take a few moments to just chat about some of the behind-the-scenes action for one of our favorite movies, Ghostbusters. First thing, we're looking at these casting choices here. Now, it seems pretty iconic that we have Bill Murray, we have Dan Aykroyd, we have Harold Ramis, and then, of course, Winston Zeddemore, played by anyone? Good research we did today.
I already Hudson. Said his name.
Ernie Hudson.
Ernie Hudson. Yes. I know it was a freebie, and you were supposed to piggyback off that. So, but you just you made no effort. So we think of, and then of course Rick Moranis' character playing Lewis Tully, and then Sigourney as Dana Barrett. That's the iconic team. Like you couldn't think of that being anything else. But there was some thoughts on this being a different sort of movie.
Yeah.
So when you were going down the rabbit hole of studying and researching for this film, which I know you two spent countless hours on.
Hours, days.
Did you come up with anything that would have said, hey, maybe Bill Murray and Dan Aykroyd weren't like the first choices or anything like that?
Yes, I did.
I was going to say, I bet this is one of the ones that had a lot.
A lot.
Yeah, there was.
My personal favorite was, of course, Reginald Bell Johnson had to play New York City police officer or jail guard.
I read that, or I saw a thing on YouTube. He actually tried out 5 times for the Winston Zeddemore character.
Yeah. Yep.
But they didn't think he was quite right. But Ivan Reitman really liked him, so they basically wrote to that part where he gets one line because they had nothing else.
Yeah.
So, of course, that fits into the Reginald Bell Johnson universe of policemanship.
That's right.
Where this is 1984, so he's a cop. And then the trauma from everything that happens in this movie as far as the Stay Puffed and all the action, it's too much. So he runs to L.A.
That's right.
And then he gets there, and of course, he thinks he's escaping the drama from New York only to run into Nakatomi Tower. And then he has to escape that drama to Chicago and become a cop with his family and live in Chicago the rest of the time.
Next to Urkel.
So it's the Reginald Bell Johnson universe. I think it's pretty complex. There may be a whole show wrapped into this. We just haven't figured it out yet. So
there's going to be a documentary written. It's
pretty complex.
Yeah. So, well, Dan Aykroyd wrote this movie. Mm-hmm. Like he wrote the original script, and the original script was him, John Belushi, and Eddie Murphy.
Yep.
So that was the original team. And he asked Eddie while they were filming Trading Places, but Eddie's like, I'm already signed on for Beverly Hills Cop. Can't do it. So he's like, okay. And then John Belushi, passed away, because he passed away. He was
wrote Slimer in
correct
reference to Belushi.
Oh, yeah.
So, well, he told them that, he wanted it when they were making it. They wanted Slimer to basically be an homage to John Belushi. So that's why he is the way he is. He wanted Animal House Belushi.
Yep.
That's what Slimer is. So, so it was supposed to be. Now, that movie doesn't sound, I'm not saying Eddie Murphy can't be funny and everything, but what I know of Ghostbusters, if Bill Murray's not there and Harold Ramis aren't there, I don't know. Like, I'm not saying Belushi and Eddie Murphy wouldn't have been good, but I think it's a whole different movie.
So. Yeah. No, I agree.
Good. Your analysis is top notch.
I would be hard pressed to all the people that we read about, because you said earlier, this is the movie that we've done that I think had the most
possible casting
possible
choices.
Yeah. But to think of any of these people in those spots is like why?
Well, did you see Lewis Tully is Rick Moranis? And for me, no one else could do that.
But it was John Candy originally. Yeah. And he turned it down.
They offered it to him.
Yeah.
He didn't turn it down. I read that he told them that he wanted to
play it as German that had two giant German shepherds. They're like, no, we've got enough dogs.
So they told him, well, you can't do it that way. And then that's when he passed on it and said, well, then it doesn't sound like something I want to do. And I'm like, he said he wanted to do a German accent. He wanted to do all this. And basically Dan Aykroyd's like, John, no, that's not.
You're doing
not
too much, John.
And John's like, well, I got other things to do. So he took off and did Summer Rental or something.
Yeah. One of the ones I want to kind of actually see how it would have gone. Christopher Walken as Egon.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I had that.
Might have been interesting.
Just to listen to
it. Christopher Walken.
I collect spores, molds, and fungus.
Christopher Walken, John Lithgow, Christopher Lloyd, and Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah.
Well, I even saw Michael Keaton, too.
Oh, and yeah, he was up for both parts.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Venkman, I saw Chevy Chase, Tom Hanks, Robin Williams, the Gutenberg.
Oh my gosh.
The Gutenberg might have been okay.
Yeah.
And Richard Pryor, also for Venkman. That was all interesting. So, but the Christopher Walken, I think Jeff Goldblum might have been interesting too as Egon. Jeff Goldblum as Egon might have worked because he's got kind of that weird thing anyway.
Mm-hmm. That would have worked.
I mean, I still think Harold Ramis is absolutely the right part, but if you were going to have another one, Goldblum might be. Keaton also was considered for Egon. Mm-hmm. So Keaton was pressing. He wanted to be a Ghostbuster, right? He's hot off the heels of Mr. Mom. He's ready to get out there in this comedy. But Keaton might not have been bad. Like if you get Mr.
He's
Mom,
funny.
Keaton, he might have been okay.
Keaton's funny.
Yeah, he might have been. I would see him more in the Dan Aykroyd character. Now, nobody else is trying out for that because Dan Aykroyd wrote the movie.
Yeah.
So he's not going anywhere. But if you were talking about the characters' personalities that you see on there, he fits more into the Ray character.
I don't know. I could see him doing
the Venkman. I just don't
think
he can
be kind of a sleazy.
Yeah, I just don't think he's sarcastic enough. Yeah. Like I think that's part of what sells Venkman is Dana makes the perfect analysis early in the movie where she goes, "You don't seem like a scientist. You're more like a game show host."
Yeah.
Right? I don't get that from Keaton and some of the other guys.
Especially since Murray wrote most of his own lines. So.
He did. Wrote. He just did them. Like, he just made them up.
Ad lib. Yeah.
So here's my half cocked internet research for Dana Barrett. I got Daryl Hannah.
Yep.
Denise Crosby, who was on Star Trek something later. I didn't really recognize her a ton, but this one though, Kelly LeBrock.
Yep.
But this one, it was online, and I'm intended not to believe
the pretty
it.
Woman herself,
Julia Roberts. but I don't think that's right because. In 1983, she would have been 16 years old.
I was going to say.
But it says she auditioned. So I don't know that she would have been 16 years old being the love interest for Bill Murray.
Yeah, I'm going to guess that that's
I think somebody wrote something stupid on a thing. So. Yeah. And Gozer. Did you see who was originally supposed to be Gozer?
I love this.
Paul Reubens.
Yep. Yeah.
Pee Wee Herman. I think that would have been better.
Are you a god?
Could you see him with the hands go?
Then die.
Stop it.
Chuckling. No. That'd be great. So we'll talk about it later, but I don't like what they landed on, but I would have preferred. But Paul Reubens, that one, he just told him no.
Yeah.
Like there wasn't I have other projects or I'm busy. He just didn't think it sounded good. I'm like, do you think later on he was like,
should have done it.
Damn it.
No.
Really? Just too much other success.
I think he did all right.
I mean, he did okay.
Okay.
He got caught wanking it in a theater. Well, I don't know if he did okay, but he was all right.
After that, he was just fine, though.
Just fine.
He took a few years off. Then he became the spleen.
Yeah, he did become the spleen. He was also in that movie Blow with Johnny Depp.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Cocaine movie.
He was in.
And then he became back as Pee-wee.
Came back as Pee-wee.
He was in the Batman movie. He was in.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. He played the Penguin's dad.
He's in Buffy the Vampire Slayer. He's a he's a vampire.
Did you know that? Okay.
I think she slays him. So oh,
yeah.
If I remember right, I've seen Buffy in a long time.
He was a vampire.
He was a vampire. Yep,
that's right. Yeah,
I think that's true.
He's all over the place.
I think he was Buffy the Vampire Slayer. He's a vampire in something. Buffy.
He's not Lost Boys.
He's not Lost Boys.
Because I remember he's
Buffy the Vampire Slayer.
Yeah.
I almost feel like we could. I feel like Kip could fact check that real quick, but we'll see. Anyway, I want to say that he was definitely in that. So
I saw that Sandra Bernhardt was going
to
be.
Was supposed to be
Janine.
Janine.
Right?
Yep.
Yeah. I like Annie Potts.
Yeah.
You made a little scrunchy face earlier, but I like her, so I'm good.
I made scrunchy face because. You commented she looked good.
I thought she was kind of cute.
No.
What's the problem here? She's got an 80s quality I don't mind. So
it's Buffy. Voice that's the problem.
And she plays racquetball.
He was in Buffy.
She's fit. Oh, it was Buffy. Yeah. Okay, I was right. I like that she's fit. She plays racquetball.
She's fit.
She likes to read. She's like a learned doctor. I mean, everything's working.
Learned doctor.
Yes. House of Is learned she? Doctor. Yes.
Is so. She?
Or she just grabbed some glasses before she went on set one day.
So for Ernie Hudson, the Winston character is interesting. If you did a little back checking on this. So he came in and read for this. He really wanted this part. And he actually, in the original script, he had like, he came in like page 22.
Yeah, he had a much bigger part.
Yeah, and when he took the role, he took a lesser salary because it was such a big part. And he knew this was going to be a big movie, or he felt it was going to be. So he took it. Then he shows up first day of shooting. Now he's on page 68. And they just basically they took a bunch of lines he was supposed to originally have, and they gave him to Bill Murray, or gave Bill Murray the freedom in that area to go. So, and then he was supposed to be. Everyone's like, "Well, why is he on the team? Because he's not a scientist. He's not a doctor. He was supposed to represent the everyman coming in and seeing them." And Dan Aykroyd even made a comment. He goes, "We also, I just pressed, and so did Ivan Reitman. We should have." Some more diversity in the cast because it's New York City. It's just all white people. Mm-hmm. He goes, that doesn't work. So that was also part of their thinking was to bring in. But yeah, Winston's because he had a whole backstory of he was originally in the Air Force as a demolitions expert.
Yeah.
Which is why they hired him in the first place. But then the movie just alludes to they put an ad in the paper and he's like the only one that showed up. So they're just like because the interview process was here's Winston. He's for the job. You're hired.
Right.
And then they just immediately hand him traps.
If there's a
here you go.
Paycheck involved, then
I'm your guy. Looked it up. I think he made 11,000. 11,500. Yeah. That was his salary. So in 1984. As long as there's a steady paycheck, I'll believe whatever you want. That's what he said. So he had a really good part in his hair, though, by the way. You saw that? And a clean mustache.
And he wore nice flannels.
He was looking sharp. Nice. When he came to the interview, he was looking sharp.
Great flannels.
He wanted a job.
He did. He was ready for that job.
Came for the, came ready for the interview.
You got any other casting things?
No, I think we had them all.
Any other casting things and or anybody else you would have rather have seen instead of who we actually got?
No, I can't imagine this movie being anybody else.
Yeah.
And I think the chemistry between them is what made it work.
I think the only part I could
see. They knew each other. They could play off of each other. They could ad lib off each other because they'd done it with each other for so long.
The only parts I could see different. I think you could, if you had a different actress as Dana Baird, I don't think that really.
Yeah.
And Sigourney's not like owning the movie. She's doing a good job, but she's not like, killing it. Well, originally when she came into audition, Ivan Reitman was like, they thought she was too serious of an actress. And so they're like, why is she here? And then he's like, but can we get Sigourney Weaver? Can't get her. And then she ended up, I guess, getting on like all fours on a coffee table.
Oh, yeah.
Acting like a dog. And Ivan said it was her, that audition that inspired him to do the, where they get possessed by Zool and those. So that was interesting. So she helped apparently inspire part of the, because I guess he was stuck on how to get them to the roof or something like that. And then she got on all fours and then she started howling and they're like, oh, and they're like, well, Sigourney Weaver will do that. And we're good.
We're all right.
A lot of things started with somebody getting on all fours.
Here we go.
There he goes.
Do you want to get back into the pee trough? Is that what you want?
I don't know.
So, crossing streams, all the good stuff. Yeah, that's right. So, I don't know. All right. Well, some interesting facts about the movie. First script was written, as I said, by Akroyd, but originally was way too long. It had time, like where they went through time.
Yeah.
And they were on different planets. And like Ghostbusters were like, garbage men where they're everywhere in every universe and they're just available all the time. And I guess Ivan Reitman read it and was like, you've got a good piece of an idea in here, but what you've written is impossible. He said it would have cost upwards of $300 million. And in 1984, that's a lot.
Yeah.
He goes to even start on that. And he goes, and it's too much. So he basically said, when I read this, it looks like starting a business was what he said. It's a starting a business plot. And then they went from there and they rewrote it. So I thought that was interesting. But yeah, Akroyd's first version of it was crazy, I guess.
I like how he got the idea because his grandpa and dad were parapsychologists.
Yeah, they were. So. They were really into it.
He's really into all that UFO stuff.
He's an interesting guy. So, when it did get greenlit, Akroyd and Reitman were given 12 months. They said it had to be ready by June of 1984. And all they had was a piece of a script. They didn't have anything else. So they had 12 months to finish the script, shoot the film, edit, score, and create all the special effects. So they did it, but they were like, at first, even Ivan Reitman, I saw on a YouTube thing, he was just like, oh, okay, that's going to be tight. Be
I read that this was the highest grossing comedy of all time.
Yes.
Until Home Alone.
Wow. Yeah. Home Alone's that's a killer.
Yeah.
It was the highest grossing movie of 84, but then they did some adjustments later and Beverly Hills Cop barely overtook it or something like that. So, but for the first parts of that year, it was the highest grossing movie. So,
in my notes, it says Bill Murray agreed to do the movie only if Columbia financed a remake of The Razor's Edge.
Yes. In fact, the day
have you ever seen that?
No.
I don't,
but they said they didn't even know if Bill Murray was going to show up. Basically, they were going off of Dan Aykroyd said, Bill said he'll be here.
Well, but he's Bill like was notorious known for,
but he was in Paris. And apparently, it's the day before shooting, and he still had not been in New York. And it turned out that he wanted to screen the edited version of that movie you're talking about before he left Paris. And they were like, well, we're not going to have it ready for weeks. And he's like, well, I'm not leaving. And then they got him a copy. He watched. Anyway, but at 8 o'clock the next morning, they were panicking, and everybody walked out, and he walked right on set.
Yeah.
He was like, I'm here. And so Ivan Reitman's like, have you read the script? And he said that Ivan Reitman said his answer was, I got the gist. And so there you go.
When you can tell that, right? Because and you've said it before, but most of the lines or Murray's lines were ad-libbed.
Yeah, so he just made up a lot of that stuff. To be fair, a lot of what Rick Moranis did ended up being
Was ad-libbed
his own thing too.
He came up being a tax guy and everything else.
I like that. We'll talk about Lewis in a little while. So,
speaking of Lewis.
Lewis, yes.
There's a scene where we were talking before about the dinner scene.
Oh, yeah.
And that when he's commenting about the price of salmon and stuff.
Yeah.
That scene is one continuous shot.
I know.
And almost entirely improvised.
Yep. Yeah. That was part of what I was really going to say. Yeah. They just shot it one take. And literally, they didn't tell the extras what they were doing. They were like, you just act like you're dancing. You act like you're doing this. And then Rick Moranis just walks around and just goes from there. That's so great. Yeah, it's awesome.
Super talented.
I love that. It's why I invited clients instead of friends. The whole thing's a tax write-off. You do your own taxes, which you shouldn't do. So I saw the marshmallow was made of shaving cream. And if you notice at the end, Bill Murray doesn't have very much on him. He would not agree to be covered in it. Mm. He didn't want his face covered in everything.
Wow.
So, a little bit of a movie star-ish move. Because yeah, Akroyd and Ramis and Ernie Hudson are like, we don't care.
No.
But he has just a little on top of his hair.
Yeah.
And that's all he would kind of agree to. So he wanted to make sure, but he could still see his pearly whites when he was doing so. I know you guys saw this, but they almost couldn't use the name Ghostbusters.
Yep.
So
why?
Oh.
I didn't see it.
You saw it?
Oh, I did.
Tell us, movie hound.
Well, originally he had to have ideas of the name was Ghost Smashers or Ghost Breakers because there was a 1975 movie that Columbia Pictures had owned the rights of that was called Ghostbusters, but then they finally dropped
that. Has like a gorilla in it.
Yeah.
Or a dude in a gorilla suit. But no.
I remember there was a cartoon.
Yeah. Well, they started filming.
Called the Ghostbusters and it had a gorilla.
Yep. Mm-hmm. They started filming and they still didn't technically have the rights to Ghostbusters. So the first part of filming, they filmed everything Ghostbusters and then they did a second take saying Ghost Breakers.
Yeah.
And they did that for like a couple weeks. And then finally, Ivan Reitman's like, I can't keep doing this. And so they basically, but what happened was the president of the studio, Universal, where they were at, he got in a fight with Coca-Cola because Coca-Cola didn't like this movie and they had bought Columbia. And so he left and went to Universal, and he loved Ghostbusters. And when he got to Universal, he now owned the rights to that cartoon and told them, go make the deal, give them the name. And then that's how it, because they wouldn't come off the name. And the company, Filmation, that owned the Ghostbusters cartoon, famous for one, He-Man, Master of the Universe.
Oh, yeah.
That was their claim to fame.
Great cartoon.
So, great cartoon. Yeah. I have the power. There you go. I knew
he
you'd
only thinks
that.
He does.
He only does. Yeah. So, we mentioned it before on another another episode we did, but the song went to Ray Parker Jr., but he was like the 50th person they called. Mm-hmm. They called people like Huey Lewis, Lindsey Buckingham. They called many others, but we talked about that before. Ray Parker's like, I'm the 50th guy? Well, he's not insulted at all. Okay, I guess I'll write a song. I was in the top 50 choices. That's good. Right. I want to know who the whole 49 was before you got to Ray Parker Jr.
I know.
You calling Elton John? Yeah,
maybe
Eddie Murphy again. He did Party All the Time. Maybe he can do the Ghostbusters song.
He was busy.
He was busy. He was doing a neutron dance. That's what he was doing. So
yeah.
In Detroit. So
Detroit.
The scenes of her apartment, the interior scenes of her apartment, Dana's apartment, filmed in L.A., not New York. Most of the streets, all the street stuff's New York, but they did a couple things on a soundstage. None of the screens were. Most of Bill Murray's, we talked about that. Louis Tully, we talked about that. So I think that's about all the interesting facts. You got any more interesting facts around?
You see, the only one I had was when they advertised the movie, they actually had a hotline that people could call, and they were getting over 1,000 calls a minute or every hour just so people could hear a pre-recorded message saying, sorry, we can't come to the phone right now. We're out catching ghosts.
Ooh, wow. That would have been good.
Clever.
I would have recorded that and put it on my own answering machine. Be like, is David catching ghosts? I am.
Yes.
In his fake ghost
my, my fake coveralls.
That's right.
Yeah. My iron on.
Ghost
what
patch.
Were those? Hey, what were those things you put them in the oven? Shrinky dinks.
Shrinky dinks.
Put them in the oven. They get small. Stupidest idea ever, but we played with them.
Okay.
So, yeah. He's always playing with a shrinky dink.
How'd
we go to shrinky dink?
Well, I think I had a Ghostbuster shrinky dink, and then I think I put it on the coverall.
Oh, got it.
So that I had like the Ghostbuster symbol.
Okay.
Along with the iron-on patch I think my mom had found.
Oh, this is very elaborate costume. Oh, it is. Turning out to be.
It's not elaborate at all. It's pretty horrible.
Threw a backpack on.
The other kids I went out trick-or-treating with, I think they got the store version of it, and I got the version I got, which was close.
To be fair, their version probably had the creepy old plastic mask that you would buy.
That would be good. So,
our parents were frugal like that.
Well, this next area is what I say, questions about the movie or plot holes. Now, I don't want to talk about plot holes too much. We're talking about a comedy of catching ghosts. No. So we can probably poke a lot of holes into several things. But there were a few things I just had questions about. So in the first time they go catch a ghost, they destroy that hotel, but they catch Slimer. Mm-hmm. And then when he's done, he charges $5,000. Because the guy says, $5,000? I didn't know it would be so much. I won't pay.
I won't pay. We'll just put it right back.
My question is it too low? Like, no one's ever caught a ghost before. Like, they're doing something no human's ever been able to accomplish. Couldn't you charge kind of whatever you want? I mean, yep. I feel like $5,000 is a little low. I feel like you're getting a deal here. I mean, because like I'm with Bill Murray. That's okay. I'll just put it back. I would have let it out right in front of him. Here you go.
I don't think they knew what to ask.
That's what I'm getting at.
Yeah. I like how Egon was the one putting up the numbers. Yeah. I would think Bill would have automatically went up $2,000 or $3,000 for what Egon wanted.
Yeah, I would have thought he would have added in a little bit. Yeah. So. And wouldn't this have been, Bill Murray kind of says it earlier before they even do it, but wouldn't this have been franchised? Because as soon as they find out they're busting ghosts in New York, wouldn't other like states, New Jersey, at least on the East Coast, be calling like, hey, can you come Salem, Massachusetts, they hung witches. I mean, there's ghosts running around those places. Wouldn't they be like, can you come get the ghosts out of here too? And this, I feel like they could have had a setup in like every city on the Eastern Seaboard and just be racking in the money. So I just thought it was interesting that it was just in New York. And they're getting famous. They're on Time Magazine. They're doing all these things. So the whole country knows about them.
Right.
So someone from Kansas isn't like, I got this noise in my barn. You think you could come take a look at it? So.
Yeah, I'm surprised that Venkman didn't.
You feel like he'd jump all over that. Yeah. And you'd think by the second one, they would have franchised that. Yeah, that's all he cared about.
He only cared about himself.
Well, he cares a little about his education. He has degrees in psychology and parapsychology. Doctorates. He has doctorates. He's PhDs. A doctor. That's right. So here's a good one about Venkman. Why does Venkman have 300 cc's of Thorazine on him when he went to a date? Thorazine is a antipsychotic, like knockout drug.
Yeah.
Why does he have that? Why is that really randomly question. With him? And I looked it up. 300 cc's would kill any human. Mm-hmm. Like you'd have like they're saying that like everything I saw on there is like it's 40 times the amount you would give a human being.
So just what he carries. He doesn't use it all at once.
Why is he carrying Thorazine around?
You know why.
And he's not even a practicing psychiatrist. How did he even get it? He can't write prescriptions for himself.
It was the 80s.
He just had it in the car.
It was a little easier to get.
Well, I think there's more to his character.
So he's going to a date and he's got Thorazine in the car just in case. So
well, the movie opens with with the shock test.
Yes.
And then
I got you.
What was written on the wall?
So I have a question about the shock test.
Was it Burn in Hell?
Yeah.
Venkman?
Venkman, Burn in Hell. Yeah. On the door.
First of all, he pays the kid $5.
$5, no. Electro.
We're paying you.
Don't worry. We've only got 72 more of these to go.
Oh, so crazy.
You only have 75 more to go.
I'm with that dude. What are you proving by shocking me? I don't understand.
Because the guy's an absolute ass. He's only doing it to get the girl.
Oh, I got this one. We're to believe that they roast the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man.
Oh, yes.
All the marshmallow flies everywhere. You know, I've made s'mores before and touched with my finger and gotten like a third degree burn. Yeah. But they've got hot marshmallow from their proton packs all over them. Wouldn't people be dead? Wouldn't that have just melted the skin off your body?
Because it's shaving.
I read that to liquefy like they did a marshmallow, it has to be between 235 and 240 degrees.
You imagine that landing on human beings' heads? They would melt. They would just turn into goo. The goo. Yeah.
They are the goo.
They are the goo at this point.
Where are you from?
The upper west side.
What's Dickless? What's his name? The character.
William Atherton?
Peck. There you go.
Pecker.
Pecker,
as they call him.
It's Peck.
That's what I've heard.
I saw a good interview with him. He said after Ghostbusters came out, he would be walking down the street and he said a whole bus of kids yelled out the window, Dickless. He said he knew then that's when he knew this is going to be a big deal. Oh. If they took the time for my character to yell that out. Yeah. So Walter Peck, Rob.
Yeah. Because he takes a whole load of the goo.
I imagine when I went as a Ghostbuster for Halloween. Right. Rob was at home going, I would like to go as Walter Peck. Can I get a vested suit? And I want to be, give me a little sign that says EPA.
I want to be the director of the EPA. I want to be the director of the EPA.
This is one of my favorite ones. So Lewis Tully tells Dana, she left her TV on. Yeah. He goes, so I climbed out on your ledge and tried to unhook the cable, but then I couldn't. So I turned mine up real loud too. First of all, they're on the 22nd floor of this building, right? Mm-hmm. And he's on the other side of the hall.
So he had to go all the way around the building.
How did he get to her ledge?
All the way around.
And are we to believe Lewis is hanging 22 stories off of a building to try to unhook a cable?
Absolutely.
Are you serious?
He's a nice neighbor.
He's a nut.
And here's my other thing about Lewis. Lewis is an accountant. I imagine he has to be doing work at some point, but no matter what time of day Dana walks by his
door,
he's
looking out of his peephole.
He comes out the door immediately. Yeah. He's either standing at that peephole or got his ear on the door. All day. What is he doing?
I'm pretty sure he just pays the doorman.
He might be psycho.
To call him.
Okay. Well, and that, like when he's having the party,
yeah,
he can hear her over the music and everything.
They have carpet in the hallway. She's tiptoeing. Even the one time when Bill Murray comes out, he thinks it's her. So he came out.
Yeah.
And then it wasn't her. And he was a little.
Then he locked himself in.
So I just thought it was interesting. I'd like to see Lewis hanging 22 stories off of the ledge, trying to unhook a cable and then having to go back inside. Like, what window did he go in or out of?
Yeah.
You know? So does the building continue? It's like if he went out on the ledge, could he walk around the entire peripheral of the? It's insane, by the way.
That's why I think some of the nonsense is so funny. Yeah.
So
just the writing.
Well, if you look when you watch two, the baby stroller or whatever goes around the ledge.
I got gotcha.
And it goes around the corner.
Different building though.
Is it?
And it is. Yeah.
I thought they just put her apartment back.
Oh, and just to go, for Lewis and Dana, so they live at Central Park West. I did a little research on Central Park West. That is a very snooty part of, that's like one of the highest expensive areas you could live in New York. It's right across the street from Central Park. It's right near the Plaza Hotel. Like everything there is very high priced. Dana's a cellist in, I'm going to assume it's the New York Philharmonic or whatever. Mm-hmm. She's an orchestra cellist and Lewis is a CPA. Those are $1 million apartments. do we feel like those? So I'm assuming Dana's parents have money or something. And like, they're encouraging her to become a musician or something like that, right?
And she talks to mom on the phone.
Yeah.
I bet she's
She appears to just be able to just do different things. Because in the second one, she's the art restorer.
Yeah, and then she restores art. So she just has an art degree of some sort.
Yeah.
But that apartment would be very, today, it sold recently, I saw online, the apartment in the, or a, an apartment in that building. $1.75 million in 2024. So in 1984, I mean, even pretty high hundreds of thousands.
Lewis is
he's a CPA.
He's a CPA for the mob.
Okay. That's good. I don't know. Does he get them generic aspirin as well?
Yeah, he does.
Yeah. He knows 600 tablets for the price of 300.
That just makes good financial sense.
He knows how to get things.
Well, this is the last one, and you're going to like this, Rob, because I know how much you love money.
I do. I love money.
So they get Ray to take out a third mortgage on his house. Let's just pretend the house is worth it's got to be a nice house to finance what they're doing. So let's pretend it's worth $500,000 in 1984. Mm. Okay. So they've got $500,000 now to build those proton packs,
mm-hmm.
to build that containment system that I don't even know what would cost. Even Ray makes it, it's pretty, you know, big. The car, all the other peripheral tools they have, all that stuff. So they pay for all that off of this mortgage thing. And I looked at that, the house they rented, the fire station. Rent estimates from 1984, about $9,000 a month.
Mm.
That's rent. And they said that Ray got a 19% interest rate on that third mortgage. So that's about $5,500 a month on a house payment for that mortgage. So $14,500 a month is just rent for his mortgage and that.
So they were undercharging.
So they're charging $5,000 a pop. They still have to pay each other, buy food. They got to pay Janine something, I assume. And then
Winston's they said getting $11,500 a year.
Yeah. And that the electric bill in that building has to be because the power grid they're running off of is insane. Like, what's that power bill even look like?
Well, so, the car.
Was what, they got to put gas
in. Well, Ray fixes all that.
So, yeah.
Yeah, Ray.
It's $4,500.
$4,500. It was cheap, even though it needed new brakes, new shocks.
New everything. New rear end.
New all. I just thought it was interesting that $14,500 a month estimate just on their rent stuff. That's before they do anything else. So they're going to have to catch 10 ghosts a month or they're not making any money. They're just going to be breaking even left and right. You know what I mean? And then is it worth the effort? And they're bringing Winston out. They pay him $11,500. So for the year, I don't know what that breaks down to.
Well, this is really all Vankman's
correct
idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So
he likes the
attention.
I'm assuming they charge $5,000 for that first one.
Being a rock star.
I'm thinking
the Vankman, everyday people weren't paying $5,000.
That's what I'm wondering when they're coming out of people's houses and stuff like that. In 84, people can't just pay them $5,000 to catch a ghost.
Maybe.
But again, if they're not charging in the thousands for each ghost catch, their bills are going to, I'm just doing some accounting work
That's
here.
That's why they were running
down. Maybe
they
need to bring Lewis on after all. Because the first thing he asks him when he sees him, who does your taxes?
Yeah.
Maybe they should, right? So, and wouldn't those, in the end, those proton packs and things, wouldn't those have to kind of get licensed with the city? I don't think you're just allowed to run around with those. Not allowed to operate a vehicle as a civilian with a siren if you're not a part of, like, police protection or EMT.
The unregulated 80s.
That's right.
Was that unregulated?
I don't know.
They're running around with those proton packs and everyone's fine with it? Yeah. What if they shot another person with them? You know what I mean?
They just barely missed that maid.
The hell are you guys doing?
What does he say? They're wearing
Accelerators on our back.
On our backs.
My favorite thing is when they turn it on for the first time, and then even Egon moves away from it. And I love that Connor made the comment. He watched with me. He goes, he said they didn't test him. Why would you not test them? Just go out back and shoot a can or something. Yeah. Like, why would you just like, nah, we'll figure it out.
I blame myself.
Yeah.
Yeah. I do too.
I just think that Egon and Ray really didn't believe anyone was going to actually call them.
Yeah.
Peter's the one holding on to this dream that this is a business. I think the two of them are like, we'll just humor Venkman to keep him happy, but this isn't going to happen. Right. So, okay. Well, you guys ready to jump into some categories?
Let's jump.
Sure. Let's jump.
Jump. Right. So, all right. Well, as we like to tell, you guys get ready because you're holding on to them, right? Pop open that Ecto cooler, and we're going to dive into our categories. Did you ever have an Ecto cooler?
That was like a high C. Yeah.
I used to have them in my lunch once in a while.
Ooh, didn't they have little
special days?
They had the gummy candy that had the stuff in the middle.
I think so too.
Yeah. And like fruit gushers.
I didn't like high C as much as I like the squeezy. What were the squeezy juices?
Squeeze-its.
Yeah. I like those. Yeah. Probably terrible for us.
Yeah. I almost didn't get to go to outdoor school.
Because of the squeeze it?
No. Yes, because of a squeeze it.
The squeeze it.
Who did you squeeze it all over?
Hey, no, the squeeze it controversy of 1989. Right. I didn't get to go to outdoors.
Didn't go to outdoorsy school.
My buddy was sitting across the table and he had a squeeze it. And I reached across and I just squeezed it when it was in his mouth.
It's in the name.
Rob, don't be squeezing things when they're in the mouth.
Don't be squeezing other people's squeezies when they're in their mouth.
And it went everywhere. Did you choke him?
It
hit him right on the back of the throat.
It went everywhere.
And then he ripped. That was gross.
This has to stop. Yeah. What grade were you in?
Fifth.
Don't squeeze another man. Squeeze it.
Sixth.
No outdoor school for you.
Yeah. I almost didn't get to go.
Did you go though?
I went.
You learned your squeeze it?
Yeah.
Have you squeezed anything since?
Nope.
Okay. That's good. All right. Well, we'll jump into our categories. Category one is our favorite quote.
They're here.
You can't handle the truth.
No. I am your father.
There's no crying in baseball.
When this baby hits 88 miles per hour, you're going to see some serious shit.
All right. This might be one of the, as we've said, one of the most quotable things ever. So how we even pin this down, I'm not quite sure. But we'll try. I'm sure we'll have multiple. So start with your most funniest, the one you think is the one you like the most. And Rob, we'll start with you.
Okay. It's at the library.
I would like it.
Opening scene. Where he goes, oh, good. You're here. Egon says. Peter says, what have you got? This is big, Peter. This is very big. There is definitely something here. Egon, this reminds me of the time you tried to drill a hole through your head. Remember that? And his reply back where he goes, that would have worked if you hadn't stopped me.
That's correct.
And I don't know why I laugh so much at that. I think I've missed it before.
Oh,
like, okay. I don't think I'd ever really picked up on it. And so I heard it this time and it was super funny. I laughed at it.
No, it's good. I always love that part.
And I had actually read that he ad-libbed that.
Of course he did. Who would have wrote that in a script?
Yeah.
But just the way he said that. Yeah. That would have worked if you hadn't stopped me.
If you hadn't stopped me. Yeah. What do you got, Kurt?
All right. For me, it's simple. And it's something that I can't ever look at a piano and not just say this to my head. Yeah. It's just the tingling of the two keys and saying, they hate this. I like to torture them.
By the way, real quick on that scene. He's got that machine.
Yeah.
And he's pushing
No idea what that does.
And air's coming out. Like, we were trying to figure out. So if air goes out, what are you testing? And if air comes in, what are you testing? Yeah.
Well, when she asks,
what does it do?
When she asks him, what is that thing? And he goes, it's complicated.
It's complicated. I don't even understand what it, what it is. Yeah. So, okay. Well, that's a good one. I like that. Mine's a little longer. My funniest one is, just as a kid, I always laughed at this. I laughed at the, where they have the dialogue where they're talking to the mayor and they're talking about, you know, biblical proportions. And they're like, fire and brimstone, 1,000 years of this. And then he goes, human sacrifice, dogs and cats living together, mass hysteria. So I've just always thought that was hilarious.
That was my number two, the dogs and cats living together, because that one I use a lot.
His sarcasm, Ray calls Peck dickless. Venkman says, it's true, this man, we used to do that at school. This man has no dick. Like, that one was hilarious.
Well, what does he say when they break him? He goes, well, it's what I've heard.
Yeah, that's what I heard. I'm going to miss him.
I'm going to get him a fruit basket.
That whole scene is great. So a couple others. I still like when they talk the first time about not crossing the streams. And Venkman goes, I'm a little fuzzy on the good, bad thing. And so he explains it to him and he goes, right, that's bad. Okay, all right, important safety tip. And then when he looks at me, he goes, thanks, Egon. I mean, I just like the way, it's so sarcastic, but it's just, it's really funny. So.
The sarcasm when they're chasing Slimer down the first time, and he goes, I think we'd better split up. Good idea. Yeah, we can do more damage that way.
I like Tully's. I taped a 20-minute workout and played it back at high speed. So I got a good 10 minutes. I got a really good workout. And then my favorite of Tully's is at the party, he talks to her. She goes, you made a date at the night of my party? And she looks at him, she goes, oh, that's okay, you could just bring him over. And she goes, okay. So she goes in, and then all you hear is, it's Louis Lepien.
Yeah.
I die laughing whenever I hear the Let Me In part. So but speaking of Louis, I love at the party. I don't know why. I didn't laugh at this as much as a kid, but now when I have the rewatch as an adult, the part where he's at the party and these two people show up. It's just a married couple. And we have soundbite.
Hey, glad you could come. How you doing? Give me your coats. Everybody, this is Ted and Annette Fleming.
How are you?
Ted has a small carpet cleaning business in receivership. Annette's drawing a salary from a deferred bonus from 2 years ago. They got $15,000 left on the house at 8%. So they're okay.
They're okay.
Anybody want to play Parcheesi?
What does any of that mean?
I don't know, but as an adult, I'm just like, oh, $15,000 left on the house. That's pretty good. 8%? Not good, but
I was going to say 8% terrible. 8%
sounds awful, but apparently in 84, 8% was great. Yeah. So here's my last one. Honorable mention. I've always thought it was funny, but it's not, I don't know if it's super funny, but after they leave the library, they're walking through the park. And Egon's talking and everything. And then all of a sudden, Venkman pulls a crunch bar out of his pocket. Mm-hmm. And he goes to Egon, he goes, you know, I'm going to take back some of the things I've said about you. He goes, you've earned it. And Egon takes it like very, and Ray's smiling ear to ear. There's some inside joke there. We don't know, but something's going on because it's like this pleasing moment where Ray's like, oh, he's being nice to Egon or something like that. But he goes, you've earned it. He gives him a crunch bar and he takes it. I've noticed in the movie, I think Egon likes sweets.
Oh,
so
He takes
those a few times. So, and then of course his, I collect spores, molds and fungus.
Oh yeah. That's classic. Iconic.
I've done that before where people are like, oh, what do you like to do on a Friday night? I collect spores, molds and fungus.
Well, and so, then, when he calls, Janine, his bug eyes, don't stare at me. Bug eyes. And then immediately he goes, Jane, sorry about the bug eyes thing. I'll be in my office. And then when Dana Egon shows up and he pops up in the background, you can see him come up over the back, and then he
almost dies on that gate.
He almost didn't make it. His shoe clips it.
Yeah. He almost went down hard.
Yeah.
So, all right. You got any other quotes?
And he didn't really need to jump it.
No, he could have. It pushes right open. Yeah.
I think we have to at least say, when somebody says if you're or asks if you're a god, you say yes.
Just like at the beginning when he goes, she goes, 8 o'clock. I was just going to say 8 o'clock. By the way, for my Charles in Charge fans out there, from the first Charles in Charge, the Pembroke family, that was the girl that played Gwendolyn Pierce. Charles's love interest.
Yeah.
That's where I knew her most from, is Gwendolyn Pierce. Yeah. Jennifer Runyon, I believe, is the actress.
Yes.
Can't name another thing she's ever been in. Nope. Ghostbusters, Charles in Charge. I'm sure she has some other acting credits. I didn't dive real deep into her IMDb. Maybe we can do that after the show. So, all right. Well, that gets us to category two, our favorite scene. So, Kurt, I'll let you lead off. What's your favorite scene?
All righty. Mine, we've already talked about. It's the party scene.
Oh, it's so good.
The party with the following chase and how it ends at the restaurant, him getting attacked by the dog, everyone just looked real fast, and then back to what we're doing.
We made a good, Connor had a good question. When he tries to get in the restaurant, why is that door locked? The restaurant's open. Why can't you go in?
They don't want the New York riffraff coming in.
I think that's Tavern on the Green because it's in Central Park. And they did not care that he was attacked at all.
No, not at all.
Nobody. So, I love that. I love Disco Inferno's playing in the apartment. That's the song.
Yeah, I love the dancing. Maybe if we dance.
Yeah, they're dancing.
The smoked salmon.
Smoked salmon.
Got it from Nova Scotia, Canada for it's usually $24.95 a pound. It only cost me $14.12 after tax, though.
That's correct. And then the brie at room temperature.
The brie, yep. Yeah.
He tells that girl, he goes, "Do you think it's too warm in here for the brie?" Lewis, I'm going home.
All I've got is the psilocybic acid.
Psilocybic.
600 tablets.
600 tablets of this. Sometimes when he's talking, his Canadian accent comes out quite a bit. Yeah. Like when he goes, "Oh, that's okay." I love Lewis. All right, Rob, what do you got?
I like the library scene, the opening scene.
Yeah.
I just remember as a kid that being, you know, now that I've seen it, you know what's coming. But when I saw it for the first time, I remember that was really startling.
I was going to say, the ghost freaked me out when she changes. Yeah. I was like,
you didn't expect it. And then that's how it opened. And you were like,
there's a few times as a kid, if you throw out Slimer as a kind of a cartoon ghost, the cab driver ghost is pretty horrible. Mm-hmm. And then you got that ghost looking pretty scary at the beginning. They get you with a couple, you know, it's a PG movie and you get a couple as an 8 to 10 year old. You're like, oh, okay.
Yeah.
So they get you twice with those. Yeah. So I love that. Yeah. But I never understood, why do they ask Venkman to collect this? Just collect your own sample.
Well, and then
Egon goes, "Here, get me a sample."
Well, and then there's that whole where they're questioning the librarian.
Oh yeah, that's good.
And they're arguing, menstruating, you know, and all that stuff. Like, why?
By the way, the librarian, mom in Ace Ventura. But also the mayor, the psychiatrist, when he goes to get committed in Ace Ventura. So we got a couple Ace Ventura actors running around. So now the library part's good. It sets up the whole movie, starts off on a good note. So this is difficult. I went with the first ghost catch at the hotel. Like, I like the hotel. There's a subtle part when he first walks in, he goes, "Anybody see a ghost?"
Yeah.
But then he stops and this lady walks in front of him and he just gives her this creepy smile and then they keep walking. I just thought that was really funny. So, and then of course they go up on the guys like cockroach, bite your head off.
Bite your head off.
They're upstairs. Again, he gets slimed. He goes, "I feel so funky," you know? And then radio.
He's an ugly little spud.
Yeah. And on the radio.
He can hear you, Ray.
He can hear you, Ray. He's looking right at me, Ray. But Egon's like, he goes, "It's slime." He goes, "That's great." And then Egon's like, "Save some for me," you know, on the other side. So I love what they're always concerned with. So I know after you saw this movie, Rob, you subscribed or went to the library to look up the Tobin Spirit Guide, correct? Yes,
that's right.
Yeah, that's right. So you wanted to
It's regular reading.
Regular reading. So, but I just love that whole scene when he does I know Laura likes it, but you know, the nice shooting text is really good. And then the flowers are still standing.
I forgot about that part.
I've always wanted to do this. Yeah.
The flowers are still standing.
And of course that part has the safety tip in it and just the sarcasm.
Yeah.
I will say when I heard this movie for the first time.
The table broke his fall.
Yeah. When I heard this, the way he delivered dialogue for the first time, that's when I first was like, ooh, I like jokes like this. Because before, at this age, you're like, you know, fart jokes.
Yep.
Just obvious funny stuff. And then you hear this and you're like, oh, I like this.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
Well, even when they're being escorted into the ballroom or whatever by the concierge whatever. And he's all worried. And just the way Bill Murray is like, he's like, yeah. He feels really bad for him, and he's pretending like he feels bad for him. Just the looks on his face. Oh, no. You know.
He's
total jerk.
Let's go to category three, your favorite Ghostbuster. So the easy answer here, I would say for the first 25 years of my life, I would say Peter. And Peter Venkman is hilarious. I mean, he gets a lot of most of the best lines. Bill Murray gets, yeah, he could be but actually, as an adult watching it more, I think Egon is my favorite Ghostbuster. His deadpan delivery, as I've gotten older, I just think it's funny. I think he's a perfect counterpoint to Murray because he's always like when she's just trying to small talk with him and he makes the molds, spores and fungus thing. And then he's Oat Tobin spirit guide. Mm-hmm. And he's just making these off. He's always concerned with the grid and this.
Yeah.
He's never doing anything fun or having a good time. He's just like, you know.
And I read somewhere that he didn't smile at all in that movie. And in the second one, he did. But in the first one, he made it a point not to ever smile.
Well, in the second one, he does that. He goes, Egon. He smiles when he says that. So, because they do the do-re Egon. So, So for me, I'm actually going to go with, again, as a youngster, I would always say Peter. And Peter's hilarious. But I think as I'm older, I kind of like Egon. Mm-hmm. I kind of like his drier sense of humor. I kind of like some of the comments he says, things like that. So, what do you got, Rob?
I'm going to go with Ray.
Oh, what? Yeah. Nobody goes with Ray.
Yeah.
What?
Nobody goes with Ray.
I read somewhere and I really like this.
You go Winston before you go Ray.
No. No.
I want Winston Zeddemore.
No. I read somewhere that they Venkman was the mouth, Egon was the brain, and Ray was the heart.
This place is great.
And that's what I like about him. He's got kind of like when he was sliding down the pole and he's like, oh, can we stay here? Let's go get our stuff. Yeah. You know what I mean? He's got kind of like him because
he acts like he's five.
That's right.
Yeah. Correct. He's got kind of a kid-like appeal. And
so
I like Ray.
Wow, Ray. Okay. Yeah. No one likes Ray. What do you got, Kurt?
I went with Winston.
Nah.
Shut up.
Nobody goes with Winston.
I went with Winston. He's the, like you said earlier, he's the everyman. He's there for his $11,500 a year.
That's right.
I did look up the annual pay for workers in New York, though, in 1984 it was
$19,600.
Oh, so he's getting a little gypped. So I hope he has a second job somewhere.
Well, maybe as they get more popular, his salary can increase. So
I just like some of his... Like, he's just there to basically just lay it down as a layman. Yeah. Like, when he's talking to the mayor.
Yeah.
Your Honor, I've been here with the company for a couple of weeks, but these things are real. Since I joined these men, I've seen some shit that'll turn you white.
He's already white. So, yeah, Winston. I mean, Venkman's the easy answer. Venkman's probably the best because he gets the best answers. But just watching as an older person, I like Egon. No one likes Ray. There you go.
The Robsters like that.
I would take Winston.
I just thought because Winston's part got cut in the movie, give him some love.
Yeah.
I didn't like that Winston bailed quite so fast. He's like, I'm going to need to get my own lawyer.
Yeah.
Like, he was out of there quick. He's like,
because he's smart.
And then the end, he gets also because they cut all the other stuff, they gave him that I love this town line at the end to kind of finish the movie off because they cut all his other stuff.
Yeah, so, that's fair.
Because he turned down some other jobs to take this because he thought it was going to be a more plentiful role. And it was not a plentiful role. But it was still impactful. The movie hound says he's the best. So those are our favorite Ghostbusters.
There you go.
That means we're going to a category four. Ooh, this is a good one. The full loja.
Do I look stupid to you?
No, sir.
Do I look like a schmuck to you?
No, sir.
Those people out there, they chill for power, for money.
This is where an actress really... you know, is commanding a moment in the movie or just really going over the top, like our friend of the show, Robert Loggia.
That's right.
Right. So we love Loggia around here. We love Loggia. We love orange juice. It all adds up. So we'll start with you, Kurt. Who's your full Loggia guy? Who's your full Loggia scene?
I didn't go with the scene. I just went with the guy. I went with old Mr. Pecker.
Oh,
just Peck.
I mean,
because he's, but he has to be
he does.
For his role. But I just thought, He delivered it well being full Loggia every time he had to do it.
I almost went with Peck in this category because I mean, William Atherton is the most obnoxious part of the movie. And by the way, I don't want to sell that guy short on his acting because to make himself so hated, I think he's doing a good job. I might argue he's one of the most like best villains of the
80s. Oh,
yeah. Like you can make that argument. So I almost went with him, but I didn't go with him. My Loggia was that police captain that comes in with him. And his name's Joe Cirillo. And when he tells him, he does that again, you can shoot him. He goes,
I'll do my pencil neck job.
Don't tell me how to do mine. Like he yells at him and everything. So I went with Joe Cirillo, the cop, because he's probably never been mentioned on any other podcast. So guess what, Joe? Thanks for your Loggia moment
Joe some love.
Yep, Joe. Yeah. What do you got, Rob?
I went Dana as Zool.
Oh, which part?
When she's in the bed.
Okay. There is no Dana.
Yeah.
Only Zool.
Yeah. I thought she sold the part.
She sold the part.
Sigourney Weaver.
That's Sigourney.
One of my other favorite full Loggia scenes is just the lightning and her.
Oh, yeah.
When they're just sitting there doing.
Oh, yeah.
And then she goes down on all fours and then turns into a dog.
Oh, yeah.
She's a dog.
She's a dog.
Oh, my God. It smells like burnt hair.
Burnt hair.
I'm so sorry.
I'm so sorry.
All right. Well, that takes us to category five. Best villain of the movie. Rob, we'll let you kick us off with this one.
You're not going to like this.
Yeah, I'm sure I won't.
I don't.
Just do say it.
It's a Robster.
What's going to happen? It's a Robster moment.
It's a Ghostbuster.
Embrace it. Yeah?
It's Winston.
Venkman.
Oh, thank
you. I mean, look.
I think the guy's an absolute ass.
All right.
He's worse than any of the ghosts in the movie. He takes the whole mortgage out on his friend's house.
Well, they're going to pay it back.
Oh, he's whatever.
Carrying the knockout drugs.
He's
for a
carrying
date.
Knockout
does
drugs.
Have the sorazine.
The franchise rights will make us rich beyond our wildest dreams. So he does say that in the movie. I'll take Miss Barrett back to her apartment and check her out.
Check her out.
Yeah. I mean,
well,
that's
I like
the bedroom,
that
but nothing ever happened in there. That's a crime.
Well,
that's
the part where he explains, let me tell you about my day. I go home.
Yeah.
If nothing, and she goes, yes, we have the same problem. You.
Yeah. Yeah. Peter's worldview still feels largely about Peter.
It is.
It's all about him.
Well, of course
and
it
he,
is.
So I just thought the first time I ever realized that.
Only
watching,
Rob.
He is a,
only
he's Rob
ass.
Would pick a Ghostbuster
it's an absolute
as the villain
ass.
Of the movie.
He Thorazine.
You're so abstract, Rob. You're such a thinker.
I really didn't have any other ideas.
No, you did. So
yeah, there was no other villains in the whole movie to pick from.
None to pick from. All right, Kurt. Let's see. Is yours a Ghostbuster as well?
Mine is not a Ghostbuster.
Okay, that's good.
Because I love Winston. Rob, do you want to hand me?
Ah. He's the best villain of the movie.
My best villain is my most memorable one as like a 6-year old.
Oh,
is
yeah.
Mr. State Puff Marshmallow Man.
You got to put him closer. He needs to, your camera's right here. You got to give him a little like close up. There he is. Oh, look at him go. So,
but yeah, he's my buddy.
He does get State Puff does get one of the best, and we didn't talk about the quotes, but one of the best quotes where Peter goes, "We're going about this all wrong." He's a sailor. He's in New York. We get him laid. We got him made. Where is he?
That's funny.
So, all right. Well, mine, best villain of the movie. I'm with Walter Peck. I'm not going to like invent this to make it hard. Walter Peck's the best villain. Like, he comes off as the most horrible, annoying guy. Just little subtle things. Like, he goes, "I'm Dr. Venkman." He goes, "What are you a doctor of?" So he tells him, "I have doctorates in psychology, parapsychology." And he purposely calls him Mr. Venkman the rest of the time. Yeah. He makes no effort to call him a doctor. And then, like,
he would have been my number
that
two.
Little face he makes when he goes, "May I please the containment facility?" No, you may not.
What is the magic
word? What is the magic word? I mean, he's just a brick. And the question I had at the beginning, would they really just come back? He's from the EPA. I don't think it would have just come back and shut the system down. I feel like there would have been some testing done because you'd want to make sure before you shut it down, you don't cause a horrible environmental problem.
Well, that poor guy, he's like, I've never seen anything like this.
Shut it down.
I didn't ask you for your opinion.
Now, this was a Rob, my honorable mention. I thought this was more on the Rob train, but I was close in this one.
Was it a Ghostbuster?
No, it was the dean of the college.
He's
a real jerk.
Yeah.
He goes, what does he say? He goes, "Your theories are poor. You're a poor scientist, Dr. Venkman." He doesn't yell at Ray or Egon at all. He just really doesn't like Peter, which might support your
Peter is an ass, so he's just giving it back.
There you go.
So, and how old
Burn
do we,
in hell.
How old do we think? He says to Venkman, "You've never been out of college." Well, let's just do some math. I think he's in his 30s. All right. Let's just pretend he's in his 30s. So he goes to school till he's 22, gets a master's at like 24, couple of doctorates, he's 26, 27. So for the last 4 or 5 years, he's just been camping out on this, we assume NYU, and that's it?
Yes.
That's crazy.
That's crazy.
What's he say? He goes,
"I've been out in the real world. They expect results.
I've been in the private sector. They expect results."
So
And I like how in that scene where he goes, "They're not going to touch us with a 10-meter cattle prod."
That's correct.
Very specific. It wasn't in feet.
Well, I like meters. That they were like, "Well, we can figure it about Harvard or MIT. Was that really a dream?"
Yeah. Like,
so you think they were professors too? They had to be doing something else, right? Or is it just research? Because usually when you get, he said they're taking their grant away. Usually when you get a grant, you got to like produce papers. But usually you'd adjunct professor stuff too. Like, I'm assuming that Stance and Egon are teaching some like paranormal classes people take.
Oh, yeah.
Imagine having Egon as your professor.
of Boresville.
All right, welcome.
Boresville.
You might need the Thorazine for that one.
Yeah.
So, all right, well, that takes us to category 6, our worst actor / actress.
Money now and a lot more when I get in that office. You can take that to the bank.
I'm going to take you to the bank, Senator Trent. To the blood bank.
I found the bat cave.
We got to get those locks changed.
She knows who we are.
Guess we'll just have to kill her.
Yep, we'll kill her later. We have work to do.
They're eating her. And then they're going to eat me. Oh, my God!
All you wanted to do was embarrass me. Well, you did it, okay? Grandfather always said you were a loser. Now you're trying to make me one, and I hate you for it.
Ah, in the honor of Michael.
Yeah.
He's always our favorite horrible child actor. So I've seen some Reddit boards arguing that because he makes you believe he's such a bad actor, maybe he's a good actor.
No.
But I don't think so. I just think he's a bad actor. So, no. All right. So this is our worst actor, actress category. I'll lead it off. I went with... I wanted to see Pee-wee Herman in the Gozer job because they got this Czechoslovakian, that's what it was called at that time, model Slovica Jovan. That sucks. Like, she's not doing anything good. And that's not even her. They had to get a voice person because she didn't speak enough English to be able to do that.
No, her accent was way too heavy.
Her accent was too heavy. And so, I don't like her. I just don't think any of her interactions. Now that I know, I just wanted Pee Wee. So forever, I'll just think she's doing a bad job.
And for someone that's so active, she wore poor choice of shoes.
I agree. So her hair looks bad.
The high heels.
They said they were trying to make her look like
androgynous, like Grace Jones and David Bowie.
Yeah. So that's kind of I just
can't tell.
Not a big fan. My runner up was, I won't tell you my runner up in case you have it. So go ahead, Rob.
Oh, you're going to hate my answer.
Of course.
Yeah. I think it's Winston.
Oh, my God. That's ridiculous.
Winston's funny. You take him out of this movie. It's the same movie.
You need him. No, it's not. He explains the thing about Jesus and the Bible to Ray. Yeah. And
who else is going to tell Ray to say yes? You're supposed to say yes.
Winston is a pointless character.
You're fired.
But you think the character is pointless, but is he a bad actor?
He's not a bad actor. Get out of here with this.
I don't know if he's a great actor.
Fantastic.
Your hot takes today are awful. You picked the Ghostbuster as the best villain. Yeah, this is terrible. All right.
Rob on Dayquil.
Rob on Dayquil is wonderful.
I got nothing for this one because I thought everybody did a great job.
Wow. Really?
Yeah. See, I almost did that.
There wasn't anybody I could say, I don't like them. Let's take them out and put somebody new in.
Well, I will give you my backup then that I also really almost became my number one, and I didn't get his name, but that other musician she's hanging out with when he goes to meet her at that circle by the fountain.
But he's supposed to be a pretentious dumbass.
It's awful.
He looks like the bad guy in Die Hard.
Spray and like it's just and even
he's got a cold.
Who's that guy? Like he's not acting good. He's doing a bad job. We could have cast a better guy for that. Can I get Matthew Broderick in that role?
Too small. Yeah.
No,
too
small. This is 84. He's not. It's 4 games. That's the only thing he's had.
He would have been 12 or something.
He's fine. He's 12. A prodigy. Play a violin.
He's dating Sigourney Weaver.
We don't know those two are
even. She likes younger men.
We don't even know those two are dating.
Oh, they're doing it.
Okay. With that guy?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. I saw a Reddit board where that's the kid's father in the second one.
No. Well, the kid people is blonde assume, in the second one.
People assume it might be Venkman, but it's not because Venkman
doesn't
talk to the kid like it would be his.
Yeah.
Although you'd saying he's a horrible person, maybe it is his kid.
Oh, he wouldn't accept that child.
She doesn't know who the father is because she was out cold.
He doesn't want to be a dad.
All right, well, that goes to category 7. Ooh. This has a great soundtrack. I own the soundtrack, so it's got a little memories for me, but we're going to pick our favorite song from the soundtrack. If you're going to keep it easy and just pick Ghostbusters, that's nice, but I went with something different. I went with the one we played for our mid-song. It's always been my favorite. I did my double finger wag to it that you did not appreciate. Yeah. Cleaning Up the Town, all right? That's the name of the song. My honorable mention, though, and I'll let you go because I don't want to ruin your moment.
I went with Ghostbusters.
Oh, of course you did. Why would you not go with a different one?
It's a classic.
It's a classic.
Ray Parker Jr.
I got you. Yeah. Kurt, I went with
Magic.
That was my backup.
I just like how it goes because it fits really well in the movie and the part and the eeriness of the music as all the ghosts are being released.
That's actually really good. That was my backup. I was weighing those two but I like cleaning up the town.
I was trying to find more about the guy that did that. There's not
much. A lot. There's not a lot. His name's Mick Smiley.
Yeah.
Yeah. If you want to get into a Mick Smiley rabbit hole.
Yeah, there isn't one. Yeah.
Did you tell? Maybe Kip can find some Mick Smiley info for you.
We tried.
We tried. There's nothing else
there. So, all right. Well, that takes us to category eight, our last category. I know we're sad, but this is our Harry Temple. Should have stayed in Aspen moment.
Aspen it is.
So this is a moment in a movie when a character knows or realizes their demise or something really bad is about to happen to them. So we'll start with Kurt. What is your Aspen moment?
All righty. Going back to Mr. Stay Puft.
Oh, yeah. Oh.
Right before the top of the building blows, you can see Stay Puft behind all the guys and his mouth's open wide. Ooh.
That's what Rob? I did.
Ah, yeah.
Right before they cross streams.
Yeah.
And he's in the background peeking out and you see him go.
Yeah, you can see the mouth open wide. And I was like, oh, that's a good one.
It's almost like you two cross streams for this category.
From time to time.
Job. There you go.
Time to time.
Good sword fight right there. So, well, mine, I went a little easier than to you. When Slimer comes at Venkman, when he comes flying at him, and he goes, so that's my I should have stayed in Aspen moment. And he's the only one that got slimed. So, you know, Ray and Egon never get slimed. So, by the way.
He deserves it.
One last thing. Those coveralls, they got to smell bad, right? Because when they put their arms up, they're stained in the pits. They're not washing those things, I don't think.
They're on a budget. So,
okay. And they only had three lockers when they come down. Did they build a fourth locker for Winston when he joined the team?
Of course.
No, because he doesn't belong
there. Stop it. He does belong there.
They made him build his own.
Your hot take with Winston is absolutely terrible. So
goofy character. I don't understand.
Okay. Point. Well, those are all our those are all our categories. And at this point, usually we do this.
Oh, Connor's Connor. He watches movies. It's Connor's Connor. Oh, yeah.
Now, I said we would usually do this because this is where Connor's Corner normally goes. Connor has run off to college, and he feels as if he's a little too busy to be wasting his time watching movies and contributing to our world-famous podcast at this time. So for the next few months, he's going to be on a little bit of a hiatus. So we're either going to, A, not have a Connor's Corner, or, Rob, I had an idea at the beginning of the show.
Okay.
Why don't you explain my idea and see?
Let's see if I can recap.
Let's see if you can recap.
So we're going to put a call out.
Call out.
To listeners.
Okay.
To see if they want to basically provide the Connor's Corner for us.
We'll have guest Connor's Corners. Yeah, guest Connors.
So we might have listeners out there who will watch the movie with their family, loved ones, and then write a Connor's Corner for us. And and we'll play it.
So if you have some sort of teenager, young adult that is at the home and they watch the movies with you, maybe it's their first time watching, maybe they haven't seen in a long time, and then they give us the synopsis, we will feature it. Email it to us. We will feature it on the show. And each week when we do a movie, your family member or whatever could be the guest Connor for Connor's Corner.
There you go.
And if we get nothing, then we just don't have Connor's Corner. So that's the way it works.
So it's on you all.
So yes, if you want Connor's Corner, if you want to support the show and support the corner, you're going to have to supply us with with the feedback. So, okay. All right. So that brings us to our last question. After rewatching this movie, covering all the big topics, what is your final verdict? Is this a classic that should haunt our hearts forever or just another forgotten 80s film, Rob?
It's a classic.
Classic, yes.
Absolutely.
Give us your top two reasons why it's a classic.
It's
Winston Zeddemore.
No.
And Venkman, the nice guy.
And Crossing Streams.
I think one is the dialogue. It's like we said, one of the most quotable movies that I know.
Oh, yeah.
And then I think just the cultural impact, right?
Oh, yes.
Toys, music, whole thing.
Hot thing I brought up this week, you going as Walter Peck for Halloween. Pretty good.
I like that idea.
Yeah, that's good.
I do.
Yeah.
I'm not opposed.
You had to adhere that glue from the 80s to your face to get the beard.
Yes.
Because you didn't have the beard back then.
Yeah.
Yeah. I want to know what you do here.
Yeah, a little EPA sticker. I like it.
You know, when they were talking about casting choice, Will Atherton's great, but like, put Christopher Walken in that role.
Yeah.
That'd be good. What are you a doctor of?
What Mr. Venkman? The magic wood.
Mr. Venkman.
That's awful.
Oh. All right. Kurt.
I'm going with it's a classic. It's gotten better over the years as I've understood the lines and dialogue and everything that you really grab a hold of it and say, yep. Plus it's gotten nostalgia from back in my youth.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Especially with the cartoon. I remember now watching the cartoon all the time.
Oh, yeah.
So
The real Ghostbusters.
Well, they started out with Ghostbusters. They ran into the same problem. That's why they just called it the second one the real Ghostbusters, because they didn't have to pay them.
Yeah.
That's what they did. So, I'm with you too. Classic. I think everything in the movie still looks awesome. It sounds awesome. Like you said, I think it gets better. It's hilarious. The special effects I think are really good, except one. I think the dog
looks a little bit like a seal.
It's
occasionally
a little rough. Yeah. Well, just the cuts of it, the way they had to cut it in, yeah. It's not there. So it's really kind of weird.
My son did say that.
So that effect, and Connor CGI, said that too.
The CGI was really bad.
There was no CGI, is what you need to retort to your son. They basically
that did not exist.
I saw a thing. They did a stop animation with the puppet, and then they had to cut it into the movie because when Rick Moranis is running, he's not running from anything. Yeah. And then they cut it in. So it's tough. Like, it looks kind of funky, but it's 1984. What am I going to do? So they got the. They wanted to get the special effects done by the Industrial Light Magic Studio, which is George Lucas's studio, but they were busy on the old Indiana Temple of Doom movie. But a couple of guys that worked for the studio were mad at the studio. They didn't like it anymore, so they branched out, and they're the ones that did the special effects for the G-Busters.
Well, they did an okay job.
They did pretty good.
They did all right.
Except for the dog. Other than that, they looked pretty good.
But at the time, it was really cool.
Yeah, it was. So, well, you two got anything else for a wrap? This thing up?
I do not.
I do not.
I really wanted to get those peas in there.
Yeah.
I was doing
it. They call that a plosive.
Yes. You know, syphilis.
Yeah.
Syphilis. All right. So, all right. Well, if you're loving this blast from the past,
I think he says sibilance.
Make sure you take a quick second and subscribe to the show if you haven't done so already, so you never miss an episode, just like you never missed Uncle Jesse and Joey on TGIF back in the day. Mm-hmm. And hey, we want to hear from you. Hit us up on X, Instagram, TikTok, Facebook. Or MySpace, if you for some reason still have that. We don't have it here, but we'll get Kip on it. Maybe we'll figure it out. Drop us a line. Share your favorite 80s and 90s memories, highlights of the show, or just slap us a virtual high five so we never forget how awesome we are.
That's nice. Avast ye spectral crew. Show yourselves ye ghostly few.
Too many ye's.
Yeah. Feeling like Gozer the Traveler coming in one of the pre-chosen forms during the rectification of the Voldrani. Maybe you're feeling like a traveler coming as a large moving Torg or a giant Slor during the third reconciliation of the last of the McKentric supplicants. Dave and I are the perfect complement to your listening experience and the perfect antidote to modern life. We are the gatekeeper to your keymaster, the Zool to your Gozer. Visit Totally80s90sRecall at Podbean.com and we will have you saying Mother Puss Bucket in no time. If it's knowledge you seek, send us an email at 80s90sRecall@gmail.com. Consider the Totally 80s and 90s Recall podcast your laughter lighthouse.
Nice.
We are the beacon of joy in a world of darkness.
Very. Ooh. I noticed you said Dave and I in there as if the movie Hound isn't playing today. No, that's okay. Yeah. It's okay.
I don't play well.
That's fine.
I don't play well.
We'll shine the lighthouse on you anyway.
Okay. Here I go.
There you go. Here I go.
Here I go. Okay, you ghouls and goblins, put down your copy of Tobin's Spirit Guide and go to wherever you get your podcast and rate us 5 stars and leave us a review. This will help the show grow and allow others to more easily find the podcast. Also, if you're feeling the chill of the supernatural, why not haunt our online merch store, discover ghoulish goodies and phantom finds that will make your collection truly out of this world. We've got the perfect treasures to elevate your spirit. So drift on over and explore the spectral selections waiting just for you.
Just for you.
Wow. That's nice.
Hey, before we do closing thoughts, I just thought of this.
Oh,
so if you were thinking of everything from this movie, band name, Rob, give me a good band name from this movie.
Mother Puss Bucket.
No, from the dialogue of the movie, you weirdo.
That was from the movie.
Mother Puss Bucket?
Yeah, he says that.
Oh, he does.
He does say that.
Oh, okay.
Did you just say that?
Did I say that? I didn't say that.
No, I did that.
Oh, okay. I knew somebody just said that.
I don't remember Mother Puss Bucket.
Yeah, he's like on the, I think they're up
Mother
on the.
Mother Puss Bucket.
Oh, wow. Yeah. I feel like I know everything. Yeah. What about you? Oh, look at we look putting him on the spot. Gozer? You know what my band name is? Vince Clortho. I like that. I feel like they'd wear suits on stage.
I feel like Rob's band would be Winston Zeddemore.
Yes, it would. The Zeddemores.
The Zeddemores.
Zeddemores. I like it.
Winston.
Room temperature brie.
That's good.
That's all right. Stupid. Well, we came, we saw, we kicked its ass. We spent the last of the petty cash and saved New York. So unfortunately, that brings us to the end of this week's episode. We hope you've enjoyed our look back at the 1984 all-time classic Ghostbreakers? It's Ghostbusters. Okay. No. As always, we want to thank the Movie Hound for sharing his cinematic expertise with us this week.
Or something close to it.
Yes, that's what we got. Finally, a big shout out to you, our awesome listeners. Whether you're tuning in for the first time or you're a longtime subscriber, we can't thank you enough for hanging out with us this week. We hope we gave you a fun hour or so of laughs, memories, and don't forget, you can catch all new episodes. Totally 80s and 90s Recall every Tuesday.
Every Tuesday. What are we doing next
time? I kind of skimmed over the fact. Did you have any closing thoughts? Because I really just went right over that.
Well, I do have one.
Oh, well, then yeah, we should. We'll do the Willy Wonka. Reverse it. Go back the other way. Rob, do you have any closing thoughts for
us? I wrote, Ghostbusters has become a cultural icon, transcending its original status as a comedy film. Its blend of humor, sci-fi, and supernatural elements has resonated with audiences of all ages. The film's characters, particularly the four original Ghostbusters, have become instantly recognizable figures in popular culture. The iconic costumes, catchphrases, and unique personalities have cemented their place in the hearts of fans worldwide. Beyond its entertainment value, Ghostbusters has also influenced fashion, music, and even scientific discourse, demonstrating its enduring cultural impact.
Your slander of Winston Zeddemore will no longer stand, well, Rob.
It will continue.
It is awful. All right, poor Winston.
He doesn't belong there.
Just has a job, man.
He's just trying to make money, man. He needs a job. Steady paycheck.
How many people just walk up to you at school and go, you just don't belong here,
You don't belong here, Rob.
More often than I need it.
All right. Well, thanks for the closing thoughts. Sorry to kind of take that out of order for
you. That's fine. I don't care.
Do you have any other questions you'd like to ask?
I'll ask it. I want to know what is Rob's homework?
Oh, Rob's homework. You know what? Easy prep week for you, Rob. Since you're feeling a little under the weather.
Yeah.
We're going to be diving headfirst into the fabulous world of 90s music.
Oh.
And you don't have to get anything ready. You just have to show up, Rob.
I don't like this.
All we like is where you just show up.
So, Rob likes to be well prepared, though.
It's going to be a surprise for you. I'll be looking for your reaction and asking for your musical prowess or musical know-how on some very special selected compositions. So
is there a theme?
No, 90s music.
That's really broad.
I know it is. It's meant to be broad. I want your actual reaction to when you hear what's going to go on.
I do not like that.
So you can prep a 90s music like opening.
No, okay.
So that you can do that. That's your prep for the week.
All right.
And you can do a closing thoughts if you'd like.
Okay.
Even though you don't know what it is.
I don't, yeah.
Maybe you can create it during the show. Do it on the fly for once.
Oh, that'd be weird.
Improv is
not my thing.
Specialty.
Right? It's not my
thing. So it's going to be fun.
Okay.
You're invited if you want. We could get your reaction too. You wouldn't
what
have
day
to
is
do
it?
Any prep.
He's like, I have a
what day is it?
He's got
Ooh, yeah,
to
I,
do.
I got, yeah. I got busy, a thing. I got a thing.
It's not a movie. Okay. All right.
I got to feed the hogs.
Feed the hogs.
Do my taxes. It's almost the end of the year. Got to get all those receipts together.
I'm just going to take them to Lewis. So I don't need to do my own taxes. So. All right then, Rob. So you got small prep for this week. You can take it easy, relax, spend some time with your family, and it'll be a good time, right?
It'll be a great time.
There you go. So you
always
get,
is.
You got anything else?
I got nothing else.
Kurt, you got anything else?
Nope, I do not.
Does anybody have a fancy goodbye?
No fancy goodbye.
No one hates Winston. No one.
No one.
He's so nice.
Most pointless
He
character.
Does wear nice flannel shirts.
I do like his flannels.
You're wearing one today.
This is my Zeddemore flannel.
That's right.
Zeddemore flannel.
Dressed like Zeddemore, but can't stand it.
But a little paler.
It's got the same
and
part.
And remember, Rob, next time, you're at the pee trough. No crossing. Don't pee on people's shoes.
That's right. If there's something strange in your neighborhood, who you gonna call? Go!